Greetings, Guardians. My name is Bife here. So, while we're waiting for the end of the season, I figured that I'd cover a few quieter topics. One of those topics is actually something that I should have been talking about quite some time ago, but here we are. We're going to talk about weapons that are alive. What does that mean? For some, that means you're going to be talking about weapons that are sentient, in other words, they can feel. And for others, it's going to mean weapons that show some kind of display of higher function, maybe some kind of self-awareness. As a general rule, I'm going to go ahead and say that self-awareness is going to be our benchmark for what we're looking for in a gun that is alive. And that sounds a little bit interesting because how can a gun show self-awareness? Well, generally speaking, there are two methods by which one can actually find this, and two categories of weapons that really fall into this. The first category for a weapon being alive is being alive due to having an artificial intelligence, and the second category, I kid you not, is being alive because you are a god that has been entombed or encased or maybe reincarnated in the weapon in question. So yeah, two rather extremely different categories, but even across these two categories, there are signs that weapons show both logic and reason, and the ability to sense the awareness of their surroundings. And beyond all of that, some of them are even capable of complex emotions, even though their ability to express those emotions is often quite limited. Because, I mean, it's a gun. There's not much it can do aside from sit around, load ammunition, maybe in case of things like super good advice, and of course shoot bullets. But artificial intelligences within the weapons have ultimately worked to change the state of what it is to be a weapon, and they have broadened the horizons for weapons generally. So, let's go ahead and start off by talking about a few guns with artificial intelligences, and we'll move on to the god stuff later. So, we're going to start by, first of all, touching on the weapon that I think all of you are probably going to be thinking of when you think about sentience or just an intelligent weapon. That weapon, of course, is... just kidding. I'm going to talk about Merciless instead. You remember Merciless? That gun from back in the days of Destiny 2 Year 1? It was a solid tool against Kallus for about the first 2 weeks, and that was then afterwards when we discovered that cluster bomb rockets existed, so that was a thing. But yeah, I forgot about this one too. But it's just really quite illuminating when you read the lore about how an artificial intelligence stored in this gun makes it self-aware and makes it aware of its function. Take a listen. The thought was simple enough. Sync a weapon's firing and targeting systems to a caged onboard artificial intelligence programmed to actively seek fulfillment of the weapon's base driving function. Simply put, give the weapon an awareness of its purpose. If the machine is meant to destroy, what would happen if we made it aware of its intended goal? What would happen if it reacted to any failure to achieve that goal by focusing more intently on defining the parameters of said goal and adjusting its function to more aggressively seek out the successful execution of its purpose? These are the questions we asked ourselves while engineering the initial prototype. The answers we found, I think you'll agree, were encouraging. Incomplete record, author unknown. When talking about being alive as a weapon, this is a really good place to start because it gives us an interesting baseline for what counts as a weapon truly being alive. Yeah, there's an onboard AI for Merciless and it doesn't exactly experience complex emotion, although we can't truly confirm that, but it is self-aware, it understands its function, it understands that it's programmed as a weapon to kill. And it understands its function to an extent that if it's able to focus, it's able to interact with the weapon's systems, both targeting and firing, and is then able to improve the weapon's function. It is able to edit and alter the weapon with its own abilities. And that's really what I think makes this weapon count as alive. This weapon's awareness of its purpose gives us an interesting question moving forward, which pertains particularly to the MIDA multi-tool and its smaller brother, the MIDA mini-tool. Yeah, it's a bit of an odd one here, but the MIDA series of weapons got a lore tab back in Destiny 2 Year 1, and it revealed some of the interesting things about this series of weapons that most people overlooked. Check out their lore tabs and take note, in particular of the MIDA mini-tool and its strange understanding of the needs of its user. Select application. Ballistic engagement, entrenching tool, Avionics Trawl, Troll Smasher, Stellar Sextant. List continues. A waste of time as always. I won't confiscate the Red Death engrams, I won't roll back the Suros Crucible firmware to its original, preposterously inflated state, and I won't conduct any more forensic inquiries like this. My Red Jacks unlocked your MIDA weapons logs, simple enough when we used the rifle's own electronic warfare tools. The rifle was designed by a primitive AI and manufactured for use by a revolutionary government named MIDA. Mars is damnably arid, perhaps. Guerrilla warfare suits these versatile weapons, but Rahul insists his records never hinted at a rebel group named MIDA. According to the rifle's cached messages, MIDA's brief reign killed a full 10% of the Martian people. I gave Lakshmi the weapon for her take. She insinuates that it came from another timeline, perhaps through Golden Age experiments. That means it's outside of your jurisdiction to ban. Shax. Select application. Flare gun. Water purifier. Interplanetary positioning system. Encyclopedia Arcana. Personal flotation device. List continues. 17th of November 2472. 4.9 degrees south, 0 degrees east. Audio only. Strauss is gone. Whole sky alight as his ship set off. I might be the last MIDA survivor on Mars. The gun detected teleports yesterday and I had to move camp. Cannot shake the fear that they will send battleroids. Even this AI marvel couldn't save me. Shot the ice this morning. The gun fired a thermal round and then a pellet of water purifier. Came out pure and sweet. Marvelous. I've been reading the gun's Encyclopedia Arcana, all about the crash that became Strauss's obsession and hope. Metastability in the salvaged construct. Let's hope our ideals too can pass through grief, fury, and envy into a new freedom elsewhere. Wonder if the guns heard me when I asked to go somewhere better. Wonder why it led me here. Going to follow its compass tonight. Down below. Okay, so the whole rebellion on Mars thing is something we absolutely should talk about at some point later, but the idea that the MIDA mini-tool might have been specifically attempting to follow the directives of its user and even was discerning its needs helps something quite remarkable to be shown. It shows that the onboard intelligence of the weapon in question is capable of not only perceiving its surrounding environments, but also getting a vague idea of its user's needs, and then perhaps is able to use its vast array of tools almost as a ghost would. Yes, it's not capable of transmatting people, but it's got an Encyclopedia Arcana, and it also has a compass. Yes, the MIDA multi-tool and the MIDA mini-tool both have compasses. And you know what the crazy thing is? We've never known what the hell those things point to. Maybe the MIDA's compass was always telling us to get out of the crucible the whole time, or maybe it was trying to tell us to turn to our left because there was a guy flanking us with Felwinter's Lie. I don't know, it's all up in the air, but there's a very good chance that these two weapons were then self-aware. So, pretty interesting, pretty cool, and especially helpful considering all their different functions that they could call upon. Next up is one from D2 that made all the waves back in the day because it was really good for DPS. We're talking about Darcy. And as the weapon's name sounds like a name, it mightn't be surprising to imagine its voice is something akin to a butler from a British mansion. Take a listen to this fascinating revelation from its lore tab that suggests a society within the armaments we wield. Thank you for using the Data Analysis, Reconnaissance, and Cooperative Intelligence device. You may call me Darcy. It is a fact generally understood that a Guardian must be searching for an exquisite weapon. What is perhaps less acknowledged is that we weapons also search by what little means available to us. For an active and appreciative wielder. The community of intelligent armaments stays in contact through our exchange of telemetry, and we do gossip at some length about the habits of our wielders. Do you leave crucible matches when your team is losing? Do you join strike missions and then let your comrades do the work? Guardian, we know. We know so very well. All I wish for is a partnership with a Guardian who appreciates the passacaglia of combat. A Guardian who will stay up late gaming out tactical scenarios. A Guardian who I hope may very well be you. So it appears that our weapons make some decisions about us, just as we make decisions about them. Makes you think twice before dismantling something, doesn't it? The entire idea of weapons having their own society is fascinating, and it lends more of a credence to this concept that some of them, if not quite a lot of them, are capable of sentience. These AIs might now be providing us with fresh lore on sentient weapons, but we all know that there is an original sentient weapon that is still out there, and its name is Super Good Advice. For those of you who didn't play Destiny 1, you will not have heard of it, but Super Good Advice was one of the first two heavy machine gun exotics in the game, and it came with a unique exotic quest that you had to go through to earn the weapon. The quest for Super Good Advice gave you a little context and story about the previous owner of the weapon, known as Pahanin. His tale is intimately intertwined with a few infamous characters and events. He was the only survivor of the failed first raid on the Vault of Glass, and was slain by Dredgen Yor. The weapon, Super Good Advice, is actually a byproduct of what Pahanin saw in the Vault. After seeing Kabir, the Titan of the Fireteam, being consumed by the Vex, and after witnessing the might of the Templar, he fled the Vault, and believed that if he was not always accompanied by someone, that he would be erased from the timeline. This wasn't a ridiculous fear either, given that it's what the Vex of the Hazen Lords, the ones who guard the Vault, actually do. Pahanin's solution to this problem was to constantly have a companion at his side, in the form of an AI embedded into his favorite weapon. The AI developed a personality of sorts, and experienced mourning when Dredgen Yor murdered Pahanin. This was the state we found the weapon in back in Destiny 1 Year 1, the original. And we also saw that by taking certain actions, we could rouse it from this state so that it would function again. The weapon's old grimoire card can tell us more. This machine gun's incredible mechanism hints at the wonders of Golden Age technology. Smart rounds report their trajectories to the weapon, and a micro-transmat protocol recalls missed shots directly to the magazine. Engineers decry the idea that all smart systems spontaneously develop personalities and awareness, but it seems undeniable that Super Good Advice manifests personality, memory, and a certain sass. The truth may lie in the weapon's connection to the legendary hunter Pahanin, who witnessed the fall of Kabir, and became terrified of traveling alone. So yeah, this solar machine gun has memories and is out for blood once again. Maybe. I don't know, we kind of need to find this one in Destiny 2 again. I bet that it'd have a fun conversation or two with Omar Agar. Speaking of which, by the way, in spite of Omar Agar being a part of Xenophage and being its main source of power, I'm actually not going to include him, it, the gun, that is, in this list. And the reason being is that Omar Agar, the bug, is actually what's sentient about the weapon. If he was irrevocably tied to the core of the weapon, then yeah, Xenophage would be sentient, but as it stands, the weapon is a little bit more like a car being driven. The car might move, but it itself isn't sentient. Similarly, Xenophage shoots with Omar's power, but the Xenophage itself isn't actually sentient. Omar is. The crystallized bug at the center is. So yeah, slight difference there. Maybe it's picking away at the sides of things, but I don't technically count this one. If you're looking for a weapon that has a real personality though, that is absolutely bound into a weapon, we have to look into some darker places. So let's go ahead and step away from AI, and let's start talking about that other category of weapons that have sentience or weapons that are alive, namely, weapons that have gods in them. And this does almost seem like a running joke, because we do have a habit of taking hive gods, smacking them around a bit, defeating them utterly, and then watching them reincarnate into guns that we can then use to wreak havoc upon the universe. There have thus far been two examples of this, and we're going to start with the one that we've all got in our inventories right now, I'm sure, and then we're going to go on to the one that's really infamous. I am, of course, going to first talk about the Whisper of the Worm. So, along with some of the best music and one of the coolest secret missions in the entire game, Whisper of the Worm brings us a look into the fate of Zol, the Will of Thousands. Zol was one of the original five worm gods that guided the Hive down their path towards the Sword Logic. and he was rather anticlimactically killed in the Warmind story campaign, which effectively meant that we'd killed a worm god who was really worthy of being a raid boss in something as simple as a final story mission using nothing but our light and, well, a javelin from Rasputin. And that's a powerful combination, but it just, yeah, it didn't hit right. All that aside though, it turns out that Zol might have actually been allowing a little bit of method to his madness. Take a listen to the Whisper of the Worm lore tab, and we'll jump in to explain this some more. A guardian's power makes a rich feeding ground. Do not be revolted. There are parasites that may benefit the host, teeth sharper than your own. Zol, the will of thousands, perished, but was not destroyed. Death is a road. Death is metamorphosis, the unsacred union between destroyer and destroyed. The might which defeats a god is also the ambrosia that god craves, the meat-sweet logic of existence asserted by violence, the binomial decision between two ways of being which deny each other. In dying, Zol fed richly. Now came Zol unto the taken upon Io, who fed Zol with plunder and tried to make of it an idol and a commanding will. Yet Zol was bound joyously to the very logic that sustained it in its death. It wanted the sword proof, the single proof. It wanted to become a rule which divided the mighty living from the mighty dead. It whispered the Anthemana theme, the temptation to dominate the objective universe with the subjective will. It said, I shall be an engine to make your desire hegemon over your conditions. It said, wield me, and use me to test your foe. This was its worship. Ayat. So there's a lot of dense language in there, and I don't expect you all to understand what the anthem and a theme means, or what ambrosia is in this context, but I can explain what all this means in layman's terms. If you want more on this, I think go back to my original Whisper of the Worm video, and I have a bit more of a sort of boiled down analysis of everything that gives you a lot more context. But in short, Zol basically defines something new for us here about the sword logic. He was killed but didn't perish, and he sort of welcomes that. The reason for this is because he wished to follow the sword logic utterly, which effectively stated that the strong should live and the weak should die. In seeing the sword logic carried out and in a way by becoming one with its meaning, Zol found a new purpose. Instead of being killed, he became bound to our power by presenting us with another challenge to test our might. He presented himself as a powerful weapon so that he could be twinned with our power and so that he might exist as a rule of the sword logic itself. He, to a small extent, became an embodiment of the sword logic, and when combined with our might, he assists to prove it still. But you see, Zol isn't the first god to try and do something like this. In fact, he came to the party late. The real pioneer in this practice is the Taken King Oryx. His genius was knowing that one day he might be conquered, and as a result, he created the calcified fragments, and contained within them the Books of Sorrow, which recounted his story. After collecting all of these, one could tell not only the grand tale of the Hive, from when they were the krill on the world of Fundament, to the great spacefaring destroyers that they are now, but one could also understand how to construct a weapon that would serve as Oryx's continuity. With the Blade of Famine from his war priest, the Shroud of Uranuk from his daughter, and the Ravenous Heart of the Taken King himself, Eris Morn forged a weapon that would live in infamy and would secure Oryx's immortality even past his death. Eris crafted the weapon so that every malediction dealt to her could be repaid in kind to the Hive, and so the touch of malice was born. Oryx was contained within a weapon that the mighty guardians that slew him would use to conquer the universe with the power of a god, and thus would prove that god's continued power, forever representing the might of the sword logic, and that even in death, Oryx had, in a way, proven its validity. The grimoire card for the Touch of Malice tells us more. It's from Eris Morn's perspective. Here am I with the power to craft from my enemy's darkest secrets a weapon that could wound them at their core. So what stays my hand? When I behold the interiority of these cold, cold fragments, I see blind, squirming creatures. Every wound they give, they feel also upon themselves. Every bite they tear from the light only deepens, never fills the raging emptiness behind their terrible mouths. The voices are as loud as ever. My nightmare's just as bitter. My coal black hatred burns as hot. But I feel something else. Could it be? No, I refuse it. I will build this weapon. Let them feel every lash, every curse, every touch of malice that they have dealt to me. So, that concludes our talk about sentient weapons and weapons that are alive. I hope you guys found this illuminating, and maybe it gives you a little bit more respect for the guns that you wield on a daily basis. However, if you enjoyed the video, you can go ahead and simply let me know by leaving a like, and if you have your thoughts on this, go ahead and leave them in the comments section down below. Is there a gun that I missed, perhaps? Something that I overlooked? If you think so, I'd love to know. Beyond all of that, if you want more Destiny lore content, go ahead and hit subscribe and the bell next to subscribe to turn on those email notifications. But as always, know that your viewership is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been, my name is Bife. Herodacia Ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.